Praise the Lord, God's children, because this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will be glad and rejoice in it. Hallelujah. Welcome to the Master's Word. I'm your host, Dr. Stefeni. My friends, all Master's Word programs are Christian internet radio and TV talk shows directed at educating, edifying, and helping the body of Christ to gain understanding of God's Word and to know just who they are in Christ Jesus. You know, every day that we start this program, and any program for that matter, we need to start in prayer because we have to invite the Holy Spirit to join us. So let's pray right now. Father, we come into your presence with praise and thanksgiving in our hearts. Lord, it's just overflowing our lips. We praise you, love you, and adore you, and we thank you that we can always seek your face and you'll illuminate your word so we gain proper understanding of it. We thank you for the Rhema word of God, the Logos word of God, for the gift of utterance, for revelation, knowledge, and manifestation of your word alive and active in our hearts and lives. Bless those that have ears to hear, Lord, as we endeavor to know you more personally and love you more deeply. And Holy Spirit, we invite you to take over this meeting right now in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. My friends, let me ask you this. Did you come expecting to receive today? Well, if not, you won't receive anything from God. Elevate your expectation level. Come in expecting to receive whenever you come to a broadcast or go to a meeting. Come in there expecting to receive something from the Lord, and you will. You'll come away with a greater head and heart connection and a greater understanding of God's Word. Now, we're moving deeper into the Word of God as we learn about being in Christ. And we find that these subjects are so deeply rooted in God, especially the ones that we're in now, that we need to do something extra in order to enter God's presence to the degree that's necessary for us to gain total understanding of the message that he has for us. So we're going to soak in music right now, in worship, excuse me, right now, for just a few minutes so that we can get closer and closer to God. And when we soak in worship, what we do is we turn our whole lives open to God, over to God. We submit ourselves completely and we just float in his presence. All right? So knowing that, let's do that, shall we? We just finished learning about the character of God and how to understand him. And today I'm going to continue talking to you about the character of Christ. We're going to be delving deeper into hupomone, and macrothymia. Now, we have been studying the character of Christ and development of character in our Christian life. And one of the most important developments in our Christian lives is being Christ-like. We were predestined to be conformed to the image of Christ Jesus, as we see in Romans 8, when we make Jesus Christ Lord of our lives. Well, when we do that, he's then enabled to give us spiritual success, emotional success, physical success, and material success in this earthly life to succeed, do, and fulfill all that he wants us to do in this life. But the most important is the development of our spirit being. Remember that no matter how successful you are in this life, you can't take your success to heaven. What you finally take to heaven is your developed Christian life and character. How your spirit man is and what your spirit man is like, that's the part we take to heaven. You can't take your house, your car, your money, and all that. It's the development in our life that we take to heaven with us. Romans 5, verses 1 through 5 tells us this. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. Now, hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Now, this tells us that we start first with faith. We are justified by faith, and then we add to the faith tribulation. Then tribulation produces perseverance. When we have studied the word perseverance in Romans 5, and again the word perseverance in verse 4 and verse 3, and it's actually translated in these three verses as patience, and many times in the word hupomone. Now, the root word of hupomeno is meno, which means abide. The word meno occurs many times in John 15. Jesus said, abide in me, and my word abides in you, and you will bear much fruit. So, when you add the word hupo, which is like a preposition, it becomes abide upon. Hupomeno means a continuous abiding upon something, upon the word of God. Hupomone is also only an aspect of the development into the next part, which is called character. Now, perseverance produces character, and we're not able to study the word character yet, which is the Greek word dokeme, which we will look at in this series later on, but we want to wrap up what we've been studying about the word hupomone, all right, or hupomone, which has been translated as patience in the New Testament. All right, now mark that down. It's translated as patience in the New Testament. There are, as we've mentioned, two Greek words for the word patience. One is the word hupomone, which is found here. The other is the word macrothymia, which is translated usually as long-suffering. All right, now, macrothymia, which is translated as long-suffering. Sometimes the translators mixed up both words, and macrothymia, translated as patience, sometimes hupomone, is patience. Okay, so there's a twofold relationship between these two words. They kind of intermingle and intermix. Macrothymia is from the word thumia, which is translated as heat, hot, or sometimes in reference to fire. Now, we've brought that to the English meaning, and a lot of the English words are borrowed from the Greek. One of those words is the word thermos, a thermos flask. The word macro is a preposition, which is a magnification of that fire. So macrothymia is a sort of burning heat and fire that's coming out of our lives. Okay, now strangely, the Bible translates it as long-suffering, and long-suffering is not the ability to endure. The ability to endure is more accurately derived from the word hupomone. Hupomone would be like you are surrounded by waves and yet you're on a huge rock. Somehow you're steadfast on that rock. And the waves keep coming and going, and the storms keep coming and going, but like a wise man whose house is founded on the rock, you are founded upon something. You are abiding upon something, and it's more or less the English meaning of the word endurance. So you're able to endure. And one day the storms die, the waves die, and you're still there. That's the word endure from the word hupomone. In other words, steadfast, you know, rooted and grounded. The word macrothymia is not just endurance. It's an ability to never let your fire die. It's also a whole different type of endurance. Okay, it's endurance that when you're challenged by circumstances, instead of the circumstances causing the fire to go out, the circumstances cause your fire to become even hotter. It's almost like a wildfire, a forest fire. Now, normally you light a match to light the candles on a birthday cake, and when someone switches off the ceiling fan, well, that's not what I want to, the way I want to say it is that you're lighting the birthday cake, you've got the ceiling fan going because it's warm in there, and somebody switches it off when you go to light the cake. Why do they do that? Because when you light a match or light candles, the wind created by the fan will blow out the tiny little flame, right? Well, that's called being quenched. Now, some people get quenched. They have no ability to keep the fire going. The slightest wind of opposition and the fire goes out of their lives. They have no endurance. But macrothumia is a different type of endurance. It's an endurance not to remain the same, but an endurance to keep the fire going and getting even brighter. Now, you translate that into a forest fire. What happens when the weather's dry and part of the forest catches fire? Fire starts by burning one or two trees, and then the wind comes along, and now the wind doesn't stop the fire. When the wind comes along, the fire will escalate. It doesn't stop the fire. It helps the fire burn hotter. Amen? So the stronger the wind, the more the fire spreads, and the more material you use to smother the flame. The more things you throw into the fire, wood, etc., the bigger the fire grows. That's what macrothumia is. It's a different type of endurance. It's fire endurance, where you have the ability to keep the fire going. But it's also the ability that arises in you that the more the circumstances come and the more you go through, the more tribulation you go through. In other words, the more difficult things that are thrown at you, your fire escalates to consume them and becomes bigger and hotter. It's the ability to increase your fire through times of endurance. Okay? All right, now as we can see, Hupomone gives us a picture of keeping. You are able to keep everything, hold fast to everything without losing one smidgen. You remain the same in season and out of season. So there's a sort of endurance and stability in your life through Hupomone. Macrothumia is a type of endurance, but it's an endurance that grows stronger. Now you have to note the difference, because when you read something in the Bible, you have to be able to translate that yourself. In other words, you have to be able to see that, what's happening, and then you can equate which word goes to it, because it makes a difference. And if it's translated, when you get into the Greek and it's translated as macrothumia and it's not that, it should have been hupomone, then you'll understand that the translator got it wrong. Okay, so the stronger the wind, the bigger you spread, until in the end the fire is so big it consumes all the circumstances around you. That's when we experience breakthrough. That's where you'll break through into the next level, and that's how you overcome. Hupomone is like, a rock standing against the waves. Macrothumia is like a forest fire that burns and can't be put out by strong winds, unlike a candle fire that's snuffed out by a wind or the air movement. But the air movement now helps your macrothumia and delivers it to it a kind of endurance. See the diff? Okay. This is all really very difficult to understand, and I know that because I'm using the Greek translations, but you need to understand this. Because if you don't understand how the Bible's translated, you'll read it at surface level and you'll never get it. So now let's try to understand the relationship of these two words, because in Romans 5 verses 3 through 4, it tells us that somehow tribulation produces character. It tells us that hupomone produces character. So let's cross-reference to 2 Peter chapter 1 and see the development of hupomone there. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 through 7. Ready? All right. But also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance. All right, that word perseverance is the same word hupomone, and it should be translated as patience, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love, or agape. Okay, notice that Peter had a different flow where more virtues and characteristics are mentioned, but it starts at the same point. It starts with faith. Then from faith it takes more steps. Let's take faith as the starting point. First step, virtue. Second step, knowledge. Third step, self-control. Fourth step, perseverance. Fifth step, godliness. Sixth step, brotherly kindness. And seventh, love. So developing from faith to love takes seven steps. And when you look at Romans 5, verse 1, you'll notice that Paul starts with faith. So let's also start from the same base, faith. Then it says, having been justified by faith, okay, we have peace, step 1, to whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Rejoice is step 2, which we didn't consider earlier in our study. We started from faith and went immediately to tribulation. Now, verse 3, and not only that, but we also glory in tribulation, third step, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, fourth step. Perseverance, character, fifth step, character, hope, Sixth step, hope equal love. Seventh step. All right, Romans 5 verses 1 through 5 also has seven steps, but when we compare it with 2 Peter 1, 5 through 7, we see that they take slightly different roads of travel. But the end result is still love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 declares that the greatest of all these is love. There is definitely a relationship between all these Christian characteristics and virtues. Now, we don't have time to consider all these relationships. In the natural world, the same atoms can be formed differently to produce different molecules and molecular structures. Diamonds and graphite are from the same element. They're both carbon. But the carbon atoms have joined together differently, and if they join together in a certain pattern, it becomes graphite, which is a very weak substance, and you could break it with your hand. But under pressure and great heat, the atoms join together to form a different set of molecules, and we call it diamonds. Their element is still carbon. In the spiritual world, it's the same way. Between the processes of faith in God to agape love, there are many different combinations that the characteristics of Jesus in our lives can take. We need to develop all of them. We need the diamond hardness in order to confront difficult situations and cut through them. We need the softness of filio in order to relate and to be tender to one another. So it's important to have those balances, folks. We're not able to consider all those balances, but I share those words to encourage you to study deeper, and it's not possible on one Sunday or even on a day during the sharing of the series to cover everything. Okay, so what we're doing here is we're stirring your love for the Word of God. There is so much in the Word that can be read and found out and discovered in the revelation God has placed there for our lives. I encourage you to get in the Word. We're going to consider the fact that hupomone needs to be developed into character. Or hupomone, also found in 2 Peter chapter 1, needs to be developed into what he calls godliness. You'll find that in 2 Peter 1, verse 6. Add to hupomone godliness. Dokeme, or character, is not mentioned, but other things that are added on in Peter 1, 4 through 7, as compared to Romans 5, verses 1 through 5, are given to us just to prove to us the fact that there's not just one single road that hupomone can take to become love. You can take any route, many routes, actually, to your church. Many diverse highways that are some of the major routes that you can take, right? However, we all end up in the same place, the church. But based on the road you travel, you face different circumstances, maybe different stoplights, different crooks in the road, maybe different dangerous areas that you have to drive through. In the first place, you pay different rates, right? The different amount of toll, for example, on a toll road based on what route you take. Some of you will try to avoid the toll road and go roundabout in a way that your experiences are different. Now, the question is it God who wants us to take a certain route? All God wants for us is that somehow in our Christian walk, he wants all of us to be complete in Jesus Christ. Now, although together we may have had different experiences based on our call, our ministry, and our personality, there is still something that must be the common bond so that we develop properly. In fact, the natural world, if you're a swimmer, you'd be like a fish in the water, right? Do you know that if all you do is just swim and you develop only in that place, you can actually be clumsy on the land? Why? Because in swimming, it's a different set of muscles you developed. If you're a runner, you develop a different set of muscles. To prove it, climb an extremely high building using the stairs. If you climb 17 stories, say, you'll find that even though your muscles are very well developed, you may start feeling muscle aches on the sixth floor. How can you feel the ache when you're so well trained in walking? Well, it's using a different set of muscles. I'm using a naturalist illustration to show that although in one sense God wants us to develop our specialized gifts, there is something that must be basic. It's a common connector. Before you can be a specialist, you must have the basics. Before you can be a medical specialist, you have to take a general practitioner's course, right? So there's an area where God allows us to specialize. That is, after developing certain characteristics. There are certain characteristics in our Christian life that are basic, which we all must have. Now, one of the examples I can give you is this. There are bazillions of ministers out here, clergy, okay? All of us have gone through Bible college, or should have gone through Bible college. Now, when we did, we got all the basics, all right? But each one of us has a specialized niche. I teach you the ultimate who you are in Christ Jesus and how that affects you in your life and how it's going to affect you in the eternal. other people, and I started with healing, and I still teach healing. That's my main thing, is that the road, the avenue that I travel to get where I'm going is through healing. Others teach about, use Joseph Prince. Joseph Prince, his niche is grace. That's his purpose. He teaches grace. He teaches all the other things. He takes you on the roads to travel to get you to grace, to show you where grace is developed all the way through it. And I do the same thing, showing you who you are in Christ all the way along the way, so that you can learn and become that total individual, that total character-building person that God wants to be totally developed, so he can use you in the avenues that he has purposed for you. That's just an example. I'm not equating myself to Joseph Prince in any way. I'm just giving you some examples there that show you what I'm talking about, the roads different, roads traveled. They all lead to the same place, love, God, right? God's love. All right, beyond that, we can learn to develop specialized characteristics according to our call, our ministry, or profession that God's called you into. You could be a car mechanic, and God called you to do that, but you witness and you show people that through your lifestyle and through your work and your giftings who God is to them, and your lifestyle reflects Jesus. Now remember that what we consider basic and sometimes very advanced for average Christians, it's because people haven't looked into the Word to study what we should have. A lot of the doctrines that are taught are very basic. Divine health laws of healing, all these are supposedly basic. But some Christians are finding it very difficult to grasp. They find it too advanced. Why? Because they never have had the basic training. And so I'm talking in this series of study only about the basic characteristics here. These characteristics we all must have. We all must have the basic Christian exercises in the development of the Christian character of our life. And we're considering the road that hupomone must take. Hupomone can take the road through character, dokame, and hope, elpis, to divine love, agape. Or hupomone can take another road of godliness, eusebia, and brotherly kindness, phileo, and then to divine love, agape, as found in 2 Peter chapter 1. There are different roads, but they end up in the same place, love. What I'm saying here is that you need both roads, folks, in order to develop correctly, because it's included among the basic development of phileo. Now, you need all the roads. It's like a map. You can go from here to there, and you can take 80 different ways to get there. But you need to know all of them so that you know which one to go when you have a detour, right? Okay. Not the specialized development of phileo. We're going to use the basic development of phileo and not the specialized end of it. These are basic roads that we have to take. And I want to summarize some of these basic roads that we're supposed to take. Even though there may be different paths that we take, there are some basic directions that are governed by the compass. The compass is the Word of God. Okay. Hupomone has different highways to agape. The key is that we need to experience all of them to develop different spiritual muscles in our lives. One is the swimming muscle, one is the walking muscle, and all these muscles are basic to our Christian life. A baby in the natural, as he gains strength, starts to pull himself up and learns to kind of toddle along and walk. Before that, he crawls or he scoots, and he learns to use the limbs that he's given. It's a natural thing for us, right? And then he learns to walk, and we help him by balancing him when he doesn't have anything to hang on to until he starts on his own, going from one person to the next. Pretty soon he's walking, talking, running. We're born again Christians, and as we're born again, we are new creations in Christ Jesus. We're just like a baby. We are baby Christians. And what happens to us is that we have to learn how to walk and talk all over again. You see, we have to change the picture, right? We are concentrating here on the hupomone development into the next step and how hupomone developed then together with macrothymia creates another avenue that we need to know about and be developed in. If you have developed hupomone without macrothymia working in your life, well, you know what? You're a very steady person, but you'll seldom change things. And if you have macrothymia without hupomone, you'll find that you can change things too frequently. And in the end, you could be changing or opposing the very thing that you should be doing because you keep changing and moving in different directions. My friends, you need both. Hupomone needs to be developed first before macrothumia, and patience need to be developed first before long-suffering. And I don't know why they use the word suffering, because the word macrothumia conveys no sense of the word suffering at all. It conveys more of the idea of heat that's being generated. So, we have hupomone together with macrothumia, and let's look at Colossians chapter 1, where we see the two principles working together. Colossians chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. For this reason we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you, and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of His will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to Him, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to His glorious power, for all patience, hupomone, and long-suffering, macrothumia, with joy. Now here you find that hupomone and macrothumia work together to help you fulfill the walk that's pleasing to God in verse 10. What was Paul's purpose? That you may walk worthy, fully pleasing Him, God, being fruitful in every good work, increasing in the knowledge of God. It's hupomone and macrothumia working together, patience and long-suffering working together. How do they work together? What they produce is what we are going to consider here. First of all, we study those words and find out how they're used in other places. The word macrothumia is actually the word used in Galatians 5, verses 22 and 23, in the fruit of the Spirit. If your Bible translates it as patience, it would be the wrong translation. It should be the word long-suffering. Galatians 5, 22 through 23 says this, "The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering." In the Old King James translation, the word patience is used, and it's a wrong translation since the word here is macrothumia. The word patience could be used if it was the word hupomone, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such there is no law. Now, I studied the word macrothumia throughout the whole New Testament. The word macrothumia seems to be expressive of a quality of your human spirit and of the Holy Spirit imparted into your life. There are some people who argue that the term fruit of the Spirit should be used here, with the word spirit having a small s and not the capital S. Some would say that this is the fruit of the human spirit, small s, and some would say that this is the fruit of the Holy Spirit, capital S. It actually refers to both the Holy Spirit and the human spirit, folks. That oneness together produces this fruit of the Holy Spirit and the human spirit. The long-suffering, the word long-suffering, or the macrothumia, has been used for spiritual attributes. And that's how we can understand that it has an overcoming quality, not a stabilizing quality. It's an overcoming enduring and not a stabilizing enduring. And that's the same one we quoted earlier in the book of Hebrews, chapter 6, verse 12, that you do not become sluggish, but imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Then in verse 15 it says, "And so, after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise." Here's where they should have used it as long-suffering and not as patience. The King James translators are not very consistent in their translation. It's not faith and patience, hupomone, it's faith and long-suffering, macrothumia. Macrothumia is like a fire that overcomes, and the more things you throw into the fire, the bigger it grows, remember? It doesn't grow smaller, and neither can it be quenched. The more experiences, the more persecutions you throw against it, the greater the fire. It's a different type of endurance. It's an overcoming endurance, and that's why it inherits the promises. It reaches the stage of overcoming. Now, as you learn in healing, as you learn about divine health and how to walk in it, we start with a lot of things, but I'm going to just jump around a little bit. We begin with understanding that what we say is what we get, right? So if we're speaking sickness and disease, we're going to get it. This is what we basically learn. I'm just, like I say, skimming over the top, the surface. So we stop saying, or we try to practice not saying sickness and start calling those things that be not as though they were. When we're sick, we call ourselves healthy. Well, because we know that as we speak it, we're changing the picture. Okay. It takes a while. But what is happening is every single time you get sick, and I'll use myself as an example, you get sick, you begin to change the picture, and pretty soon you'll no longer have the sickness picture at all. Because that macrothumia fire, that all-consuming fire, overcame the sickness, period, and wiped it out. Example, in my own life, I used to get laryngitis. Every time I would go to church and have to sing a solo, I'd get laryngitis. My pastor used to say that it was a mental thing, that I was all consumed in self and that I was nervous and I had stage fright. That's not the case. Anyway, one Sunday I got up, it was time for me to have the solo, and I went in to get dressed and I had no voice at all. Couldn't talk. I'd lost my voice completely. As I went into the bathroom to shower and get ready and put my makeup on to go to church, I said to the Lord, you know, and I spoke, but I mean, you know how you speak silently in my head. I said, Lord, how come this happens to me every single time? I am so sick of this, it isn't even funny. I don't want this to happen to me anymore. And he showed me, I had an open vision, and he showed me how there I was standing in the bathroom, and in silhouette, I saw myself just totally black, like somebody had cut me out of a piece of paper, you know, and I was standing there, and he said, you see the light at your bottom of your feet? Well, there was a light glowing, but it was inside of me glowing outwardly, and like a little yellow, like a spotlight would be, or one of those that you use for PowerPoint. Like a, you know, one of those, and it was glowing, and it was right at my two big toes put together, and it started to move upward, and as it did, it illuminated my body, and it no longer was just a black piece of paper, like it was in total darkness. I was looking like myself, but from the inside out I was glowing. That thing moved up my body and kept pushing out all the darkness. And he said, you know, stand and put your arms out like you're standing, like you're on a cross. And I did, and I watched it happening all the way through as it completely illuminated me from the inside out. He said, where's the darkness? And I said, it's gone. He said, sickness and disease is darkness. And you are born again. That is the light that's within you. That's the Christ in you, the hope of glory. And so you have that healing thing, that healing power within you. And it's working continually to push out darkness and keep you healthy and whole. Well, you know, it was so overwhelmingly vivid to me, I got the picture. So every time that I would get sick or try to get sick, by the way, I walked out of the bathroom that morning and my husband said, well, how are you feeling? I said, I'm fine. And my voice was back completely. I went to church, sang the solo, everything was great. Hallelujah. Anyway, so I was healed right then. My point is this. That healing power is within us. When you're born again, you get Jesus Christ. So you know what? And you get the Holy Spirit. You've got the power. It's within you. It's inherent. It's abiding in you. And you're abiding in it when you take it and use it. See? So that was what I'm talking about, is that glow inside of me is the macrothumia. And the understanding of the macrothumia, which is using that power to visualize myself with a solution and not looking at the symptoms all the time, the lying symptoms, it became to build the fire bigger and bigger and bigger until finally one day I walk in divine health completely now. I'm not saying I don't get symptoms. Symptoms try to come, but I recognize them as lying symptoms and I turn around and what do? I build that bonfire up. And what happens? Nothing. Nothing happens to me because I'm healthy and whole and walking in divine health. That's how it works. It works and works and works and works and works and continues to work until it's finally so big that it consumes all of it, all of the ugliness, until the devil will leave you alone in that area because you have gained total understanding of what divine health and wholeness is and how to achieve it. Verse 15 is talking about Abraham, and also after he had patiently endured. Now here's the word long-suffering again. After he had long-suffered, macrothumia, he obtained the promise. It's a different realm altogether. The macrothumia is the result of the development of the human spirit with the Holy Spirit enabling it. And that's what happened to me the day I had the vision, the open vision in the bathroom. The Holy Spirit connected with my human spirit, and it put me up and over. It just pulled me up and over. I was overcoming, and I overcame sickness and disease in my body. All right, the difference between, and it wasn't in my body, it was on me. It's a lying symptom. The difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament is not that they don't have a human spirit. Human beings are tripartite beings. They are a spirit, they have a soul, and they live in a body. The difference is that we have a new human spirit once we're born again. Theirs was under the law and under a different dispensation. That's why God can't indwell them. He can only work through them here and there. And you'll find in the Old Testament references about the Spirit and their understanding of it. In Psalms it says that the spirit of man is a lamp. It's like a candle. So they do have some understanding about the human spirit. And the difference between them and us is not that they don't have a human spirit. All human beings are tripartite type, right? Those who don't know God, their spirits are dead. The Old Testament, through the blood covenant, has a certain measure of access into the human spirit, but it's still the old human spirit, whereas the New Testament saints have a spirit man that is born again. We are born through Christ Jesus, and because of that we have his DNA, and we are a new creation, and that's why only then can the Holy Spirit come and dwell in us permanently. Let's get back to the point on the long-suffering. Macrothumia is an attribute and development of the Holy Spirit and the human spirit in our life. Our human spirit needs to be perfected, needs to grow, and this can only be enabled by the Holy Spirit. What about hupomone? I've studied hupomone, and it seems to be a development of the human soul. It's a steadfastness that needs to come into the human soul. Let me give you a few cross-references. Luke 8, verse 15. But the ones that fell on good ground are those that have heard the word with a noble and good heart, keep it and bear fruit with patience, hupomone. So there's a relationship between hupomone and the word of God. There's a relationship between macrothumia and the spirit of God. Based on Galatians 5, verses 22 and 23, there's a relationship between macrothumia and the Spirit of God. Based on Luke 8, verse 15, there's a relationship between hupomone and the Word of God. And all through the New Testament, hupomone and the Word of God have a very integrated relationship. Abide in me, and let my word abide in you, and you shall bear much fruit. Jesus is using the word meno, which is the same root word of hupomone in John chapter 15. And all through the New Testament, there's a relationship between macrothumia and the Holy Spirit. Now, when both work together, you have the balance of the Word and the Spirit. Luke 21, Jesus was talking about the end time. But in the process, he gives a revelation of something that is useful for us right now. Luke 21, verses 18 through 19. But not a hair of your head shall be lost in your patience, hupomone, possess your soul. All right? If your hupomone controls your soul, I repeat again, there's a relationship between hupomone and the Word of God and the human soul. And there's a relationship between macrothumia and the Holy Spirit and the human spirit. And both are integral to the development in our life in order to be the person God wants us to be and do those things God wants us to do. We see in Hebrews 10, he's writing to these people, encouraging them. The author of the book of Hebrews, whom we believe to be Paul, even though his name was not mentioned, and his style of writing is quite different. That's why some scholars think it wasn't Paul who wrote Hebrews. It has only been over the last couple of hundred years that people didn't think that it was Paul. However, the traditions, as given in church history and the early fathers and all the early groups of people in 100, 200 to 300 AD, recognized that this was Paul's epistle. It was only during the last 100 to 200 years that people thought that it wasn't Paul. When Kenneth E. Hagin saw the Lord Jesus Christ in a vision, he asked the Lord whether Paul wrote the book of Hebrews or not, and the Lord told him that it was indeed Paul who wrote this epistle. In Hebrews chapter 10, he's writing to people who are being tested, going through tribulations, discouraged and downtrodden. He was trying to encourage them. First of all, he showed that macrothumia could do what it could do in the life of Abraham and other people. And then, now he comes to them in Hebrews 10, verse 35, and says, therefore, do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward. For you have need of hupomone, patience, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise. Now, if you read it in the Greek, you wouldn't realize that Hebrews 10, verse 36, receiving the promise, is different from Hebrews 6 on receiving or inheriting the promise. You wouldn't realize it because Hebrews 6 uses the word macrothumia and Hebrews 10 uses the word hupomone. But hupomone is used in a different way. We see here that it's used there in the context of after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise. Earlier in Hebrews 6, verse 12, that through faith and macrothumia, you inherit the promise. Long suffering. But there is a difference between receiving the promise and inheriting it. One is more of a manifestation, and one is that you still have to grab a hold of it and hang on. Then he continues in verses 37 through 38. For yet a little while, and he who is coming will come and will not delay, and the just shall live by faith. Another word, hold on, be stabilized. But if anyone draws back, my soul has not pleasure in him. But we are not of those who draw back to perdition, but of those who believe to the saving of the soul. Again, you find hupomone related to the soul. So, for clarity, I'll summarize some of the points in the studies we've done. Hupomone is the development of your human soul in relation to the Word of God. Since the fall of man, the soul of human beings has been wavering. Doubts come from your soul. Distress comes from your soul and emotions. And all the wrong things that's coming from your soul. The human soul needs to be girded with the Word of God to be stabilized. An unstable soul will not receive the promises of God. Remember, Jesus said that if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can tell the mountain, remove from here to yonder, and it will be removed. But when you speak to it, don't doubt in your heart. You see, one tiny little doubt will cancel the whole process. Doubt is the quality of the fallen soul, and that's why we need the renewal of the mind and the Word of God to stabilize our soul. You'll notice the more Word you have in your life, the more you're stabilized in your soul. Hupomone takes a special form. A patient soul is an attribute that you want to have. Hupomone patience is not an attribute of your human spirit. It's an attribute of a renewed soul and a renewed mind. Patience is an attribute of your human soul according to the Word of God. Having understood that hupomone relates to the Word of God, which needs to come in to stabilize our soul, and macrothumia as an attribute quality, and fire of the Holy Spirit that needs to come in to give certain quality to the human spirit, we now look at James chapter 1, where we see the process taking place. Are you totally confused, or are you with me? I hope you're still with me. In verses 2 through 4, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces hupomone, patience. But let patience, hupomone, have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Now notice, hupomone is not enough, or otherwise James wouldn't have written, let patience, hupomone, have its perfect work. Having hupomone is not enough. In verse 4, it says, let hupomone have its perfect work. That means you can't receive it just once. When you receive the Word of God, be ready for the Word of God to be challenged, tested, until the Word of God is digested and becomes a part of you. Look, if you eat a piece of bread, the bread enters you through your mouth, and you chew it. It enters your stomach then, after you swallow it, and then your gastric juices come and digest it. The bread had to be digested so that it can become a part of your body to receive the nutrients, right? So the word you receive needs to be digested by your spirit, but it needs to renew your soul until your soul is steadily held by the Word of God. And this means that when the Word of God comes, it produces faith in your human spirit. But faith in your human spirit must become trust in your soul. Your soul must develop a sort of faith and confidence in the Word of God. Faith is an attribute in the human spirit. Trust is an attribute in your soul. Your trust with all your heart, you trust with all your heart. Heart is spirit and soul working together. It says in Hebrews 11, verses 1 through 3, verse 1 says, faith is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Then he goes on to say that by faith we understand. Why do people doubt? It's because their soul hasn't been undergirded by the Word of God. The Word of God needs to come to us, and within our ear gates and eye gates, it has to be constantly fed to us, okay? In the parable of the sower and the seed, what happens when the Word of God comes? Remember one type of ground, they rejoice, but they have no root in themselves? He's not just talking about the root in the human spirit. They need to have the Word of God rooted in their soul. The book of Proverbs says the Word of God can become flesh to your bones. But in order to do that, it has to flow through your soul, which is when the Word of God becomes a part of your thinking. The way you think is according to the Word of God. You know, there are a lot of us, when we grow up, we have diversified education outside the Word of God, and we're brought up by the world system, we're taught the world system and principles, and we're taught worldly ambition. When we're born again, our spirit's regenerated, but our mind is still not renewed yet. This mind of ours, this soul of ours, needs to be taught to function like the Word of God says. Our soul is the mind, will, and the emotions. We have to renew ourselves as the Word of God says and function. It has to be re-educated. And when the soul begins to obey God's Word, hupomone, patience, begins to be perfected. The soul believes to the saving of it. He's not talking about being lost in hell, because when you're born again, you have a ticket to heaven. But he's talking about the renewal. The word save is the word sozo, which means the complete salvation for the spirit, soul, and body. The Word of God affects all three parts of the human being. Why do people who are born again still look like not born again people by the look of their faces? Well, I mean, Jesus is your Lord. Jesus is your Savior. He's the Lord, but you look as if he's not the Lord of your life. Well, nobody likes me. He's not the Lord. Is he? You don't know my problem. Is your problem the Lord's, or is it only your problem? Is Jesus truly the Lord? You see, your soul needs to be renewed, to be readjusted, to think like the Word of God, to feel like the Word of God, and when your soul is renewed, hupomone is steadfast. Hupomone is complete. Where there is complete hupomone, patience, you won't have the full assurance of faith. You won't have the full assurance of faith. You will have only partial assurance, half assurance, a quarter of assurance. We need the full assurance of faith, folks. And when hupomone in James 1:4 says this, let hupomone have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Now, when it's perfect and its work is perfect, then you have a perfect and complete answer to all your prayers, all the things you want. Your soul is now lined up with your human spirit, which is born again, okay? God can't come forth to overcome the circumstances in your life. It goes on to say in verse 12, blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who loved him. It goes on to tell us how temptation is not from God and how it's more our own internal inclination and weaknesses that need to be overcome. The temptation is not found in your spirit. The temptation is found in your soul, in your flesh. And when those areas are conquered by patience, hupomone, and it's renewed by the Word of God, your human spirit can now together work with your soul, and the Holy Spirit becomes available. He's the free gift of grace and promise of God to our lives. But why can't the Holy Spirit work mightily in our lives? Well, he's limited according to what we ask or think, limited according to the limitations of our soul, our mind, will, and emotions. You have a fantastic reservoir, folks, but if all you have is a rusty old pipe, you still won't have the fullness of the reservoir. Our human soul is a conduit by which the Holy Spirit flows through in this pipe. Therefore, we need to develop our soul in the Word of God. It's the natural attribute of the fallen nature of our soul to be wavering. You talk to the average person, their thought life isn't in their control. You talk to the average Christian, their thought life is only sometimes in their control. But if you talk to a real man or woman of God who is like Jesus, all their thoughts are always in line with the Word of God. The closer you are with Jesus, the more your thought conforms to His image. Day and night your thinking is about Jesus. You're equating everything that happens in this life to Jesus and what He did and how He'd handle it. And it's so easy for Jesus to flow through your life and work in your life and do all that He wants to do. Did you receive this today? I pray that you did. I know I said a lot. I said a lot. We'll break it down further as we go further. But if you need assistance with understanding it, contact me. I can be reached at masterstouchhs@cox.net. That's masterstouchhs@cox.net. poet@cox.net. poet@cox.net, or mthsprayer@cox.net. You can also go through the website, themasterstouch.org. On my webmail there, go to drstefeni@themasterstouch.org, and I'll spell it D-R-S-T-E-F like Frank, E-N-I, @themasterstouch.org. Hey, my friends, clear your calendars for the Master's Touch Healing School Annual E-Crusade. E-Crusade 2015 is scheduled for August 17th through August 21st, broadcast right here on Spreaker.com. We commence at 8 a.m. and continue through 4 p.m. daily for that five-day stretch. We broadcast nonstop the Word of God. Our theme for this year's E-Crusade is God Knew Us Before the Foundation of the World. This is wonderful, wonderful material, let me tell you, because you're going to come away with a tremendous understanding. We have a wonderful slate of speakers to bring you the Word of God and an understanding of all the nuances of our theme. All of the E-Crusade broadcasts will be archived on Spreaker.com, YouTube.com, Twitter.com, Google+.com, and themasterstouch.org. You don't want to miss it, and come expecting to receive. I want to invite you to join us every Monday at 10 a.m. Pacific Time, coming up pretty quickly, for Living the Word. Pastor Karen Weitzman and I bring you the explanation and practical application of God's Word and promises to your life today. This is a live broadcast on Spreaker.com every Monday at 10 a.m. Pacific Time. In addition, we've extended our Sunday worship services to include an evensong service at 7 p.m. on Spreaker.com. And if you haven't been able to make the 8 a.m. worship service on Sunday, here on Spreaker.com you can now join us for worship on Sunday evenings at 7 p.m. Pacific Time. Come join us for evensong worship and come expecting to receive. And on Tuesdays, you can join us at 9:30 a.m. Pacific Time for Sweet Hour of Prayer. This program is designed to teach you what prayer is, why we pray, how to pray to receive the desired results every time you pray. Join us every Tuesday at 9:30 a.m. Pacific Time on Spreaker.com. And once again, come expecting to receive. Just as a little note, for a season, we've moved all of our programming onto Spreaker.com, which is now, it now includes our Sunday morning worship, Tuesday healing service, sweet hour of prayer, and Fridays in the Master's hands. You may still attend our church services and enjoy all of our programs daily and weekly at their same broadcasting times, but they're here on Spreaker.com now. Brethren, Proverbs 4:7 tells us wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get wisdom, and in all you're getting, get understanding. That's exactly what we're doing here, my friends, gaining God's wisdom. Therefore, make sure you're keeping Jesus, Lord of your life. As born-again believers, we are in Christ. Therefore, 1 John chapter 4, verse 17 applies to us, and it tells us that as Jesus is, so are we in this world. So how is Jesus? Strong? So are we. Abundant? So are we. He's full of life and divine health and wholeness. So are we. He's able to do the works of the Father successfully. So are we. As Jesus is, right now, right here, right this very minute, so are we in this world. My friends, meditate on this scripture until you become it. 1 John chapter 4, verse 17. The Master's Word is a subsidiary of the Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International. We're a 501c3 organization. Have a safe and wonderful week, and I'll see you again on Thursday. God bless you.